Let's begin. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar with BioMicrobics. Right now, I'd like to introduce Bob Rebori, president of BioMicrobics, and he will give the state of the water industry.
Thank you for attending. Just as a reminder, if you have any questions, go ahead and put them in the chat box. We'll answer those likely at the end of the presentation, but if it's necessary, we can do so during the presentation if it's more important to do it that way.
Okay.
And there's someone else needing to be admitted. So this end of year webinar, the state of the decentralized water industry, is going to be really several things. One, it allows you to take the slides that we're going to show you here, which have a lot of words, but there are things that you could use in your own presentations or for your own training with your own constituents. And then two, the idea is to spur imagination, to think what the future might be like. And the future could be as soon as 5 years, but the future could also be as far out as 25 to 50 years. But to think of the opportunities. And we'll go over some of these examples as we go through the program. So these are kind of the major topics here, the history of BioMicrobics, some of the United Nations goals regarding water, some updates and regulations. These are mostly within the United States, but they have correlation to other locations around the world. A look at the different types of wastewater solutions that actually affect our source of drinking water, and of course, questions and answers at the end. So we founded BioMicrobics in 1996 to focus on decentralized wastewater treatment applications, and we started with single-family homes. However, in the last 25 years, not only has BioMicrobics and our companies expanded greatly, but so has the industry. So we provide solutions for wineries, breweries, hospitals, food and beverage, agriculture, industrial, frankly, anything and everything you have in a community that's on central collection and treatment, you have in communities that are not on central collection and treatment, the same all around the world. And a lot of this same technology is utilized for marine applications by one of our companies for wastewater treatment on ships and offshore platforms. And then our drinking water disinfection technology is also used in a form of ballast water treatment to kill invasive critters in ships as they go from one region to another. So this is an interesting fact. These are not things that I have off the top of my head, but more than 80% of the wastewater that's treated and released, or untreated and released, is dumped in the rivers and the sea without any reuse whatsoever. This is a huge resource. So we need to start thinking of wastewater and other things as resources or opportunities as opposed to waste. We might touch more on this a little bit later as we go. So this is obviously something that takes place in our country, in the US. Surveys say that a lot of people are worried about their water. But if you notice at the bottom, less than half say that we think everything is excellent or good and that it's improving. That's interesting because more people think that the glass is half full as opposed, more people think the glass is half empty as opposed to half full. We're going to touch on that a little bit later as well. Of course, we all know about leakages in delivering water to all of the households and buildings in old and aging pipes, same with wastewater. It too leaks. And then of course, you could see that almost 2 billion people lack access to clean drinking water. That might be a very large underestimation because what we would consider clean drinking water here wouldn't be considered clean drinking water in some other places where they think they have clean drinking water. And then as population increases, we've always had a need to create more water. And of course, we all know there's only so much water available for consumption. So most of the world is suffering from a water scarcity. And if you think about it, very few countries have more water than they'll ever need. Most countries are suffering from dry and drought conditions. So the UN comes up with this clever illustration here to show you all the different things that clean water can affect, from gender equity to all sorts of things. Rather than read all these off, this is something you can view on your own, but the idea is that clean water has a greater effect on things than we think. Water recycling could help with a lot of the water scarcity, and this would be true of the nearly 2 billion people that don't have the water that is required. So we'll concentrate on this a little bit. PFAS chemicals are known as the forever chemicals that are now appearing in all of our water sources. They're called the forever chemicals because they don't break down in the environment. They're forever present unless you find a way to remove them. We are working on technologies to remove those, and there's various ways to do so, some that are less efficient than others. Same with chemicals and pesticides. And then, of course, you have nitrogen and phosphorus. You have other things that can affect your drinking water substance. And then along with the chemicals, you have endocrine disruptors like birth control medication or medication for cholesterol, things like that, that stay in your drinking water. Many years ago, I put in a wastewater treatment system to clean up groundwater that was contaminated by a chemical factory that had three different owners. It was called Astori Cordova. It was in our country in the state of Michigan. It was a Superfund cleanup site. It was only recently, within the last couple of weeks, I happened to be talking to our doctor, Reza Shams, who at the time was employed by Black & Veatch, a very large consulting engineering firm. And little did I know that he was also involved in the same project. But essentially what they did is they calculated the size of the area that was contaminated with this plume of contaminated water. They placed wells around that perimeter and they forced water down those wells to force the polluted water up to the treatment plant. The treatment plant would treat the water and pump it down into the wells, which would force more water that needed to be treated up, until finally all the water was treated over time. So if you could imagine that right now we have a problem with all of these substances in our drinking water sources, what if every one of the facilities that had treatment systems in a decentralized application, including buildings that were on central treatment, got a chance to treat and reuse that water for toilet flushing, gardening, what have you? The same effect would happen as that Superfund project. We would continue to remove, with each pass of wastewater treatment, another level of PFAS, chemicals, pesticides, and nitrogen, as we continue to reuse the water and save money. Remember, I'm trying to make sure that we use our imagination to solve problems. So these forever chemicals are used in everyday things. Think like Teflon, think like plastic packaging, all sorts of things. There are a lot of drivers in the need for water infrastructure. In many places, there's a rise in urbanization, more crowded cities. There's more restrictions for direct discharge, rising energy costs, and a rise in demand of water sources. So let's use our imagination again. Yesterday, the Philippines got hit with a Category 5 typhoon with 180 mile an hour winds, 260 kilometer per hour winds, with torrents of rain. It was their 25th typhoon of the year. Can you imagine if they could develop technology so that when those typhoons come through, you could capture the energy from the winds to treat water? And if you can capture that water and treat it and store it for eventual use during drier periods? So instead of looking at it as a hazard, look at this climate change and these severe weather events as perhaps an opportunity. So here we are. This is a map of the United States. Can you tell which part of it's water scarce? All the colors would give you some idea. So that's going to grow, because in the center of that map is where I'm sitting here in the state of Kansas. And the western half of our state is in a drought. I'm in the eastern part of the state. And guess what? We just got the tiniest amount of rain last night after about a month. And it was during winds of 80 miles an hour, 120 kilometers per hour in December, with temperatures that were almost summer-like. Well, regarding septic systems, many of them that have been installed were never really designed to take out nutrients. Now we're looking at doing more of that, but also nutrients are in short supply for farmers as well. So rather than looking at the nutrients as a hazard, maybe we should look at capturing the nutrients as an advantage so that we can use them in agriculture, because they definitely need them. So this would be the US. Roughly 25 to 30% of the people in our country are served by septic systems. And of course, that continues to grow. But the rest of the world is 95% of the world's population, and most of them are served or not served by decentralized wastewater solutions. So this one is interesting. This comes up every so often. Yes, the government's going to fund a whole bunch of money for infrastructure, but the traditional thought of using this money is on the old style of systems, which are very expensive. Big pipes, very large central collection and treatment and distribution systems. Could you imagine if this money was used in a more efficient way for decentralized treatment, which would actually cost a lot less money to acquire the equipment, a lot less money to install the equipment, a lot less money to operate and maintain the equipment, and a lot less electricity usage? That $1.2 trillion might be the equivalent of, say, $5 trillion, or let's just say at least $2 trillion. In other words, it would be significantly more efficient. However, the traditional thought for funding water and wastewater has always been through governments. Imagine this. We all have cooking stoves. Most of us have washing machines and dishwashers. We all have heating and air conditioning units to some extent. And they're all made under certain regulations to meet certain standards. Yet they're serviced all by private companies. They're sold and serviced by private dealers. They're purchased by private property owners. The government isn't funding any of these, unless they're subsidizing solar panel installation. But it's all through the private market. This is the future of water and wastewater treatment. It'll be set to certain standards and set certain goals, but it won't be government funded. It'll be funded through the private industry, people with a need. So there has been substantial progress. not only in central wastewater and drinking water treatment systems, but also in decentralized technologies. And if we look at using our money and our resources more efficiently, it certainly points to decentralized solutions. So what's it going to look like in 20 years? Again, I'm trying to have everybody think of the future. Use your imagination, because everything is possible. Water reuse, I don't think it's an option. It's absolutely necessary that we're going to have to treat and reuse the water. We've been doing that for billions of years since the dinosaurs, except that now we need to do so more efficiently than we have during the last million years. We have to coordinate with integrated water resources management rules, certifications, testing, micropollutants, and the forever chemicals that need to be removed in treatment. And again, if you could remove them more than once, you'll have a higher efficiency of removal over time. Same thing with nutrients, but again, maybe we can capture some of these nutrients so they could be reused in a positive way. And of course, using decentralized technologies in an urban environment for water reuse. So there are a lot of growing reuses, and there's lots of different types of ways to do that. This photograph is showing a membrane bioreactor that happened to be installed in a winery for water reuse. Now, this is where I'm sitting right now. These two buildings are the BioMicrobics headquarters. We have other locations in Maine and in the state of Missouri and in Houston, Texas, but this is where the main manufacturing is for us. This is what we looked like when we first moved into this facility in April of 2018.
Water is the number one resource that provides life to everything.
People don't know enough about water. Nature doesn't make more water. All the water we have is all the water we'll ever have. In this day and age, we need to learn to manage water better.
We've got to really make sure that that natural resource is cared for.
BioMicrobics is a manufacturer of on-site water, wastewater, stormwater equipment for single-family homes to cluster subdivisions to community properties. We have four different wastewater technologies, three different gray water technologies, and three different stormwater technologies.
When I first started the company, I said we were going to run the business using the three P's. Our products, our people, and our policies were going to make the difference, and that all of our products had to be simple, low cost, and robust. And to this day, that's how we treat everything, whether it's a marine application or a land-based application. We have over 80,000 systems in over 80 countries.
You know, we impact potentially every aspect of a small community by providing an essential piece of that necessary sanitation infrastructure.
We're actually four companies in one. We have our main global headquarters here in Kansas, and then we have our marine division located in St. Louis, Missouri, that's Cyanco Fast, our Septatech location in Maine, and then we have a fourth location in Houston for ballast water treatment.
Biobarrier, that's a membrane bioreactor, and a membrane bioreactor doesn't just remove the pollutants, it removes all your viruses too.
It's a new technology. It's essentially the most advanced form of wastewater treatment system.
The other things are a sanity screen. We now make them in different sizes for wastewater. We make them in different sizes for stormwater. They're used to protect our pumping systems.
We provide a solution that hopefully goes unnoticed by everyone because it is so simple that it just works without them thinking about it.
Wherever there's human activity, there's a sewage problem, there's pollution. It's actually giving water another life and another use.
It's a flush toilet and the water goes away. We are the one who are at the other end of that flushing toilet, trying to capture it, treat it, and send it back to the environment.
A big part of this company's success is really the diversity and the people that work here. You pretty much got whatever you need just from our staff here, and they work with our technology really, really well.
We have a very diverse workforce here. People speak different languages from different culture background. People from like three continents work in our company, and we're not a very large company.
As a team, we're able to collaborate together and bring our thought leaders together to solve real world water related problems.
I'm proud of the fact that I come to work after all these years and I'm still looking forward to come to work here and a smile on my face.
And to have that positive impact on, you know, people and health and environment by coming up with a solution that impacts someone's quality of life, essentially.
So in that video, you saw a brief shot of our building with the solar panels on the roof. Once we moved in, we converted all the lights inside of the building and inside the offices to LED, and we have solar panels on the roof. Last month, the month of November, our electric bill was $75. So this is just a screenshot of some of our products, but more importantly is this. Robust aerobic eco. We have 26 and counting short stories under SOS Save Our Septic on our website. They're written by a professional writer. They're roughly 3 pages long, but they're written for laypersons. So many of your customers, many of your constituents who don't really understand wastewater treatment and water treatment and why they might need something, we're putting these fun stories together for those individuals, for anybody's use. So I would like to point that out, that something that could be used again for their imagination for what's possible in the future. This is kind of a cheat sheet showing some of the products that we have and where they might be used in certain markets, whether it's residential, commercial, food and beverage, and so forth. These are some pictures of products that are in application. All these pictures happen to be a different version of what we call our fast wastewater treatment systems. These are by and far our most popular. We have over 80,000 of these in over 80 countries. This is our membrane bioreactor. So you can see them in the bottom left here, inside of a circular fiberglass basin. These were used for a floating fishing camp in British Columbia to treat and direct discharge the water to a pristine environment. The same technology was used in this low-income residential area in the state of Massachusetts. And if you look at this particular statistic, more than 90% of drinking water systems in the US have no more than 10,000 customers. That could apply to almost everywhere around the world where you have small villages and communities. This is why you really need simple, low-cost, and robust systems. Things like dishwashers that every one of us know how to operate, a washing machine that everyone knows how to operate. And if they don't work properly, that we can call a relatively large group of service people that can come and repair or replace these things in a very short period of time. This is really the future of water and wastewater treatment. So here's some other reasons why we want to go to advanced technologies. Again, we're showing membrane bioreactors in this particular shot here, but we talked about aging water infrastructure, rising costs for energy, and other factors. These are always going to be with us. So people with a need, we're providing solutions for that. This is actually a very good illustration. It's another 3-minute video. This is a wastewater treatment plant that was in such a state of disrepair in the Alembe district outside of Durban, South Africa, that it wasn't operating. In fact, it had plants and weeds growing out of it. They came and purchased one of our decentralized technologies. It's 160,000 US gallons per day, which equates to 800 cubic meters per day of wastewater treatment. And they put this in as an experimental system, and you'll see how simple it is, and you'll see how clean the wastewater is that leaves the unit after only a week of startup. That's the old plant. You can certainly tell the old technology. And this is the future. These blowers are relatively quiet. No oil to change, no V-belts to change. These screens are extremely efficient at screening out non-biological solids and staying clean. This is the wastewater treatment.
And they're in Wisconsin. So you can, we're cheap. Yeah, they are.
And in here we have pre-aeration with non-clog aerators where the screens are located.
I don't know whether it's still true or not, but back in the 70s when we were up there, you got a piece of cheese with every apple pie you bought, every piece of apple.
So be patient with the video. So again, this is the aeration systems. This is one large monolithic wastewater treatment system. Those are not completely individual cells as they're all mixing with each other. This plant gets looked at about once a month, and we have others like this that only get visited 2 times per year, no full-time operators. There was a shot early in this that showed the sludge drying beds, but that's even a simple process of opening a valve and letting the sludge get pushed to a drying bed, and the sun dries the sludge and they reuse it for fertilizer. Again, it's not something to be wasted, it's a resource. So that's where the water is going to go, that ditch. It's the original one that goes directly to the environment, I believe a river. That's the chlorinator. And bear with us for a second. Again, they started it up with raw wastewater, no seed sludge, nothing. And in less than 1 week, this is the results. And they have the test results to prove that it really is that clean, where it's as clean as it looks. And that's the water coming out of the system. That's better than most of the operated wastewater treatment plants that have full-time operators. So we talked about simplicity. So this is one of those modules, and they have different things. Look how they're installing these by hand without a crane. And I believe this is in Kenya. So water scarcity, we all hear about it. We're not going to go away from all of these centralized municipal wastewater plants, but we can use decentralized wastewater treatment to help improve them or help them expand in a distributed formula. And this actually helps on cost to purchase, cost to install, and of course, cost to operate. And you know, those systems that I showed you in those videos, there was no moving parts inside that wastewater and nothing to corrode. It was all plastic and stainless steel. So, integrated water resource management, residential water recycling, commercial, marine, nutrient reduction. Let's talk about marine for a second. I talked about how I thought in the future that all wastewater and water treatment systems could be done just like we do our heating and cooling systems, our dishwashers and washing machines, other things that we have serviced all through a private network. Well, guess what? All of the wastewater treatment that we do in the marine industry on ships and offshore platforms are done to the IMO and the US Coast Guard specifications that are worldwide, but they're all done through private industry. So is ballast water treatment. It's all funded and maintained by private industry. Not one government dollar worldwide, not one government currency of any type worldwide is used in any of these applications. And these are bigger, more complex applications than any of the normal ones that we're talking about in decentralized applications. So we really need to educate people that what we're doing is really in the near future, within the next 5 years, and will only get more common over the next 25 years. So I have one more thing to demonstrate here. I've placed three glasses at the front of this conference table, okay? All three of the glasses are the same, except this first one is upside down, so clearly it has no water in it. Well, having no water is definitely not an option, okay? This glass is half empty. So if I want to think of the future as half empty, I would drink from this glass. And there's certainly a lot of bad news out there and a lot of bad water. But I tend to drink out of the glass that's half full because I have full confidence that we're going to improve the technologies so that we can have better water over time. And right now we already have more good water than we have bad water worldwide. So as we close out this year, for the Roman calendar, I want to have a toast to all the people that have a glass that's half full. Cheers.
Cheers, Bob. Thank you so much. Very informative, as always. And like I said, we will have the recording with the audio from that video that was shown earlier. So I do encourage everybody that participate here that to be able to take a look at that link to be able to hear the video. Are there any questions? We can open the floor now.
I know I didn't go over anything that's very technical, but we're capable of answering technical questions as well. This was really to expand everybody's imagination so you can do the same thing with your constituents.
Okay. If anybody'd like to unmute and state your question or use the chat box. We've got a lot of time left. You can let us know what water issues that you're currently dealing with and be able to have a discussion on that as well.
Well, a very good example would be, would everybody need to use a membrane bioreactor to get the clean water? Well, it depends on your water reuse. So for instance, if we look at the FAST technology, a lot of people are treating the wastewater and reusing the water from it for irrigation. And that's perfectly acceptable. And you wouldn't need to have the slightly more expensive and slightly more labor intensive membrane bioreactor. But if you need to remove some of the endocrine disruptors, if you need to remove the viruses, if you really want to reuse the water for drinking the same way we use that technology to make our own beer here in the office, If you really need to use that technology, you want to make sure it's simple. So let's talk membrane bioreactors for just one quick second. There are many companies around the world and very many large corporations around the world that are manufacturing membrane bioreactors. Every one of them has large drums of chemicals with automatic controls because they need to be backwashed or backflushed with chemicals every 2 weeks to keep those operating. We tested for 1 year in the United States, no chemical cleaning. We tested for 1 year to the Canadian standards in another cold climate, no chemical cleaning. We tested for 9 months in Aachen, Germany at PIA, similar cool climate, no chemical cleaning. That's by design. So we chemically clean our membranes every 6 months, whether we need to or not. And ours is a simple device. The operator opens a valve on the discharge side, pours in a little bleach, closes the valve, and we're complete. So these are the simple things we're looking to do. That's actually a more simple operation than actually having a lawn service company come to your home and apply fertilizer.
Absolutely.
So again, the private development side of this is really the future. People with a need, people solving problems.
I do have a direct message question. What's the percentage of BioMicrobics BioBears that have been installed and in use in the northern climates?
Well, that is a good question because most of them are, especially in our country, most of them are being installed in the northern climate. Northern Illinois and Cook County around Chicago on very small postage stamp slots. The state of Minnesota in the northeast part of our country, some in the state of Maine, many in the state of Washington, which isn't exactly cold, but it's definitely not a warm state. Idaho, which is also quite cold. Canada, Ontario.
Alaska.
Alaska, thank you. So more so than we think. And whoever asks that question, that's a good question, and they're astute because the colder the water, it affects your flux rate or the flow through the pores of these membrane bioreactors in a negative way. Yet we still tested and designed so that our membranes, even in these very cold climates, are still in relaxation roughly 40 to 60% of the day. What does that mean? They're not being asked to filter 40 to 60% of the day, which means that they're not clogging, which means that we're also using a lot less electricity because we're only using enough to keep the biology alive, which means that we're using a lot less chemicals to keep the membrane clean, which means our membranes are lasting way longer than 7 years in the environment before they need replacing. It means they're really simple, low cost, and robust.
Another direct message information is an invitation to participate in a water treatment article. So we'll be happy to submit some information on that particular invitation. So we thank you. Are there any other questions?
Now, I know we only touched on water, but a lot of the things that we've presented here today and the future concepts of how these things might get used really touch health as well. For instance, some of our disinfection technologies are used to actually kill the viruses, including the COVID-19 virus. And they're certified for that.
Okay. Any other frequently asked questions that you've been answering throughout the year?
Robert Holder has one. Go ahead, Robert.
Hello, Bob. Just wondering if you've been working in Argentina recently. We're in the wastewater industry down here, been here for 25 years, the same as you. Wondering if you're doing anything down this way.
We have. As you know, Argentina economically right now is in a pretty bad stretch. It seems to have a history of going up and down. That's not uncommon for Argentina and frankly, other parts of Latin America, but we have. As a matter of fact, one of our latest projects was a brewery for InBev down in the Patagonian region of Argentina. And a brewery and a winery have two things in common. They're both very, very, very high strength wastewater. And they both have a lot of sugars, so they can be difficult to treat because of the amount of sugar. But the brewery also has one other factor. The wastewater comes out very, very, very hot. So what we did is we used our screening devices that are very simple to do three stages of anaerobic settling to help anaerobically digest the very high VOD from the grains and cool down the wastewater, and then do the final wastewater treatment with our fast wastewater treatment system for the final polishing. So we did talk about doing all of this very simple, but it takes a lot of people with experience to know how to make these systems a solution that are very simple. So even though they're very simple in the end, it took a lot of know-how to provide the solutions, to know which parts were pulling off the shelf and in what sizes and what combinations to come up with these unique applications. Otherwise, we've done some residential systems in Argentina, and I believe we've actually done some marine applications as well.
Okay. We do have a question. Do you think there's a coming supply chain issue?
We know there is. So yes, it's been a big problem for a lot of things like electrical components, plastics, especially things made from GRP or fiberglass. That's not likely gonna be a forever situation. That's likely gonna clear itself out, but there's always gonna be a shortage of something in the industry. I believe really the shortage of something might actually be the chemicals and the metals that are used to make batteries for electric vehicles and other things like solar panels, the silicone, things like that. We are big on alternative energy, and we actually have a line of residential systems here that are designed to work with electric motors that are 24 volt brushless DC motors that can run directly from an alternative power supply, or in other words, take the power directly from the batteries without using an inverter. And an inverter, which converts low voltage to high voltage, uses electricity to do that. If you don't need an inverter, you get to use all your alternative energy for the purpose intended.
Okay. I have an embedded question here, discussing how temperature affects clogging. An average of 7-year replacement is very interesting.
So the membrane bioreactors that have been the most successful in treating wastewater, especially for removing the viruses, are ultrafiltration. That means the pore size is roughly 0.03 microns on average. So they're really, really small. And but that's what it takes to do two things. One, to hold back the viruses so they don't get through the membrane and into the environment. And two, there's, we call them endocrine disruptors, right? Birth control medication, cholesterol medication. We also have quaternary ammonia compounds, the chemicals that are used as disinfectants in all your detergents, all your hand soaps and other things. They're very harmful to bacteria, those quaternary ammonia compounds. And so the membrane bioreactors and the ultrafiltration size of the pore size helps hold all that back so we can, one, remove the virus, and two, assimilate all those quaternary ammonia compounds, break them down before they get into the environment. And guess what? Ever since this pandemic, there's a lot more cleaners being used, especially in commercial facilities. Therefore, you have a lot more quaternary ammonia compounds finding it into your wastewater. So it's even more important to assimilate that now. It used to be that we saw them in higher levels only in, say, doctor's offices or hospitals, or even on weekends from schools when they're cleaning the floors without a lot of water use. But now we're seeing them in all sorts of places, hotels, rest areas, truck stops, every place where they're using more chemicals and cleaning more often.
I see. Does anybody else have any other questions or points of interest to discuss? We open the floor.
There is one more thing. This room is a good example. Two of us here are pretty old. We've actually spent almost all of our lives in water and wastewater treatment. One of us here isn't as old, but has significant experience in water and wastewater treatment. And then we have two individuals that are relatively new. This is what it takes. You have to start someplace, and the next generation is going to be the one that takes over from this generation and is going to continue to make the improvements that's going to allow us to be even more efficient at doing water and wastewater treatment, because we don't have a choice. Remember, the glass that's upside down, that's not an option. And for those where the glass is half empty, that's not who we want in our industry. We want people who understand the glass is half full.
Very opportunistic. Any new products that you can give us a sneak peek or preview or discussion on?
So we are working on smaller versions of our ballast water treatment systems for smaller applications. There is a growing need and a demand for that. But we are working on several technologies to remove the forever chemicals, the PFAS chemicals. Two things there. One is regulations are changing to prevent companies from using or producing these forever chemicals. That might make the biggest impact over time. But for now, all of our water around the world already has these chemicals. So to remove those chemicals that already got into our water resources, it's the technologies that I've been talking about, membrane bioreactors, and some other things that we're actually working on as we speak to help coagulate those forever chemicals to our magic elements so that they can physically be removed and disposed of properly. The endocrine disruptors, slightly different approach, because that's more of a physical removal, although removing PFAS is a physical removal, but we're trying to get them to attract something to remove them, as opposed to just physically holding them back. But yes, we're working on those, and they all affect not just wastewater treatment, but what will be our future drinking water treatment systems that are designed to be simple, low cost, point of entry, so that we reduce the need for chemicals, reduce the need for electricity, and reuse the water at a lower cost. Remember, only 3% of the world's water is fresh water, and currently 2/3 of that is frozen as glaciers. So that leaves 1% of the world's water that we've been reusing since the dinosaurs. And with more and more people, we're just gonna have to be more efficient at reusing that water. So treating and reusing your wastewater is very often less expensive than finding more raw water to treat and use as drinking water.
Great. Great overview and insight into the future and focus for BioMicrobics.
Think of the Philippines. The Philippines and Indonesia, they're roughly two countries made up of 7,000 islands each. It's actually more than that. But let's just say 7,000 plus islands each. They get clobbered by unusual weather events where they either have more water than they need or want, or they have no water and they have a lot of pollution. Well, what if they could harness that storm water for future treatment and reuse? What if they could harness those winds to create the power that would treat that water over time? What if they reused all of their wastewater instead of trying to add desalinated water, which uses a lot of power and is very expensive to own and operate and maintain? And what if it was all done through private industry without the need for government dollars.
I think it would solve a whole lot of world water issues.
Obviously, if there wasn't government dollars, people with a need, we would all be doing that ourselves. Because remember, the glass that's upside down, that's not an option. The glass that's half empty, that's the pessimist. We're all going to die. But the glass that's half full, we're going to find a way to get clean drinking water. Think of wastewater as a resource. It's not waste, it's an opportunity. Think of sludge as an opportunity. And I think we need to think of these extreme weather events as future opportunities. Could you imagine when these weather events happen, like the winds that we had here yesterday, the amount of that we could have gotten from wind energy?
Mm-hmm.
So I think we need to think of these things as opportunities instead of catastrophes.
Well, with that said, I think that that is the state of the water industry with Bob Rebori. I thank him for his time. I thank everyone that participated on this webinar for your time. And we're always available to answer questions, whether it's connect through our website at biomicrobics.com or phone calls, emails at sales@biomicrobics.com. We're here to help educate, provide technical information, and if there is a current need, please give us a call. We're happy to discuss any of those current projects that you may be working on.
I have one more closing comment.
Okay.
Would you rather treat and drink your own wastewater than treat and drink the wastewater that comes from others? Do you really think they want to drink and treat the wastewater that comes from me? You're going to want to treat and drink the wastewater that comes from yourself, or maybe your family, or maybe your building. You're probably not going to want to treat and drink the wastewater that comes from anybody else. And that's what we're doing right now.
All the water we have has been treated and recycled over and over and over again. We just keep it on site.
So I know what I prefer to drink. I know what I prefer to eat. I would prefer to have that recycled for what I'm going to drink.
It's just a mindset. Well, thank you very much. We'll conclude today's webinar if we have no other questions. Appreciate your time, and we hope to hear from you here in the near future.